logamba kau juga.
Jadi
ini adalah level sekarang. Kalau itu on and A adalah level. Ini kalau mungkin ya.
Boleh pusing ya? Boleh pusing ya? Boleh pusing tadi? Oh, aku kena pusing laptop.
Pusing? Mana ada kamera kalau tak? Okay. Masuk ke settingan dulu kalau nak letak laptop misalnya menghadap slide, menghadap tu semua. Ah, berarti tak? Maximize kan kau punya ini kau boleh tadi memang lambat ada few second lagi. Baik, ini kita tengah live, nanti kejap lagi boleh keluar. Macam ni kenapa dia lag?
So my topic today, I will cover you whatever necessary for exam is, but if you are interested, I will add up a little bit more on how to manage it easily. Okay? You don't want to just like take ABG, 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 and ABG, but then you don't have the accounting. Okay? So this is actually quite a boring topic. Seriously, very boring. Okay, if you just want to know basics, then after a few basics, I think you can go asleep. Right, but if you really want to know in depth about it, it's not that interesting. Very dull. Okay, first of all, we talked about ABG. What are the components in ABG? Everyone know about pH, right? pH 7 is neutral. Okay, so thinking about our body system, we are producing acid every day. Okay, all the process produce acid, but our body has a very good buffer system. So it buffers it at slight alkaline range. Our normal body pH is at 7.35 to 7.4, it's slightly alkaline. Okay, now another concept about this pH is it is a measurement of concentration of acid, hydrogen ion, right? But it is in what type of measurement? pH is negative logarithm. Okay, so you cannot take that 7 or 6 as the figure itself. Okay, or another example is if I tell you that patient pH fall from 7.4 to 7.3, it is definitely different from 7.1 all to 7.0. You get that? Yours is converted in a mathematical way. Okay, so although pH wise is the difference is same, 0.1. But at different range, the changes in concentration are very, very much different. Okay? Then another parameter is oxygen, partial pressure of oxygen. Okay? Normal range is 80 to 100. Your definition of respi failure is 60. We don't wait until it fall until 60, right? Normal people, no one is near 60. Okay, so if you take the normal range of PaO2, pyrite is supposed to be 80%. Oxygen saturation, SaO2, is as stated, like, usually it's around 95%. So the people will tell you it's 96%. Still okay, eh?
Yeah.
It's very, very simple. PA CO2, CO2 level 35 to 45. Okay, and my cup is 22 to 26. Now, certain textbooks will put a slightly different value. There are textbooks that say from 20 to 28, some are 20 to 26. Now, slight variation, but the as long as it's, it is a normal range around 24, it is okay. And base excess. I understand some of you asking like, what is this base excess? What the hell is that? Okay, base excess, by definition, is if you imagine the body extracellular fluid as a container, right? Total, you got about how many liter of blood? Around in healthy 70 kg, around 5 liter of blood, right? So you take that 5 liter of blood out. Okay. How much of the extra alkali or extra acid that you need to pour inside that 5 liter to make the pH 7 neutral? Okay. That is the concept. Okay. Or in short, if your base excess is negative, then no base up. That patient is acidic. So, right. If it's very, very much acidic, you've got very, very negative value. Okay. If your excess is a lot, base is actually alkali, right? If your base is very, very, base excess is very, very highly positive, that means your body system is very alkali. You need a lot of acid for it to make it neutral. Okay? Now, normal value, anyone got any problem? You must make sure that you get the basis correct first. Because in the interpretation of ABG, any step that you have got, probably you better stop me now. Okay? You'll go on until you understand, then only you can move on to the next step. Right? So, interpretation of ABG. Let's say you take one ABG. The first thing you want to look at is actually the pH. And you know already, right, the pH value, normal value. Anything lower than it, we call it acidosis. Anything higher than it, we call it acidosis. Very good. Not the rest first, we'll go on to step. Okay, so first, we determine whether it is acidotic or alkalotic. And bear in mind, usually in clinical, you see more acidosis or more alkalosis. Like what I tell you, our body keep on persistently produce acid. All pathology, majority is producing acid. So alkalosis, your question about alkalosis actually, not to say won't happen, yes it will happen, but actually less common. Okay? If anything you need to worry about acidosis. Okay? And although the figure maybe that is 0.1, 0.1 kind of changes, but anything below 6.8, it is not compatible with life. It's not compatible with life. Okay? Just by 6.8, almost often, usually the patient will die unless you do something really quick. Right? Right? Because if you remember that your science here, like our body are made up of all the proteins and enzymes. And all these proteins and enzymes get characteristic if they function at the narrow range of pH. Anything more acidic or more alkaline will happen, it might bind to your protein and cause conformation changes. Remember that or not? So anything like 6.8, your whole body system will shut down. Okay? No metabolism happening. That of course you will start. So after you determine that, the first step is acidic or alkalotic. Next, you want to look at two other parameters. One is PCO2 and the other one is cup. Both also you need to look at. Okay, doesn't matter which one first. Now, if you look at PCO2, okay, what will happen in PCO2? When you have acidosis, your PCO2 will But PCO2 has something to do with respiratory, right? Respiratory. So I rephrase my word. Okay, what is the condition in respiratory that causes acidosis? When you are not breathing very well. Okay? When you're breathing, not only the O2 come in, but CO2 is coming out. Right? So that is your respiration. Okay? So when you are hypoventilating or totally not ventilating at all, CO2 will accumulate. So respiratory acidosis, you will have typically ECO2 high. So in opposite of it, if you are ventilating, hyperventilating too much, so your CO2 will come out excessively. Right now, so your CO2 in your body, your blood and energy will be low. That is a condition we call as respiratory alkalosis. Okay? And then PCO2 high is acidosis. PCO2 low is alkalosis. Any question here? Good. Then next we move on to bicarb level. Okay. So how about bicarb? Bicarb doesn't present as bicarb alone in our body system. Okay? It's in the equilibrium. Okay? Bicarb will bind together with acid to become H2CO3, your bicarbonic acid, and which further that binding is only happen for a little while. Right? And after that you'll be carried by your red blood cell to your lung and quickly to dissociate again. Become H+ ion and bicarb. Okay? So you'll dissociate again to H2O and CO2. And your CO2 will be CO2 is a gas side, so from the lung to out. Right? So it's that equilibrium. Usually in acidosis, what will happen? More binding of bicarb with hydrogen ion. Okay? So once you bind, your bicarb will go lower. Lower. Am I confusing you? Yeah. Okay. So in metabolic acidosis, that means in your blood, whenever there's present of a lot of H+ hydrogen ion, metabolic acidosis condition, your bicarb level will go
low.
Okay. Now in vice versa, when your the hydrogen ion is low, and your body got metabolic alkalosis, then the H2CO3 will dissociate more to the end of H+ CO3. So in metabolic alkalosis, your bicarb will be high. Understand that? Okay. So I rephrase that. First, we look at pHI to determine acidosis or alkalosis. Second, we look at two figures together. Bicarb and also PCO2. When your PCO2 is high, that is respiratory acidosis. PCO2 low, that is respiratory alkalosis. Bicarb high, that is metabolic alkalosis. Bicarb low, that is metabolic acidosis. Okay, clear? Now, so to determine, this chart tells you which one is the primary problem. To determine, you look at the respiratory component and the bicarb component and the metabolic component. If your respiratory component is mainly acidosis and your pH is the acidosis one, then your respiratory is the primary disorder. I repeat that. First, you look at pH. Kalau pH, if the pH is acid, you look at between your component of respi or metabolic, which one is the one that causes acid? Right? If your pH is an acidotic one, if your one of it, like let's say your metabolic is the one causing acidosis, Then metabolic acidosis is the primary disorder. Get me? And of course, the primary because the final result is your PHI. Your pH is acidosis. So the main cause of it must be your metabolic, which causes acidosis. Or if your pH is acidosis, you look at the metabolic and metabolic is acidosis. But recipe is acidosis. So your main problem is, that we call it as primary disorder. Your primary disorder will be recipe acidosis. Whichever component that causes the acidosis would be the primary. You get that? Okay, so let's look at this chart. The one in the red color arrow is actually the. It's okay. So you can see the red color arrow, right? Okay. So the one in metabolic acidosis, pH is of course the acidotic one. So you look at bicarb and CO2, which is the one that causes acidotic, we term it as primary. Okay, bicarb is low, that is metabolic acidosis. So this is the primary problem. Okay, until this, anyone got problem? Okay, now, when your metabolic having a problem, acidotic, your body is smart, they are trying to compensate to make your body system normal again, as normal, as close to normal pH as possible. Okay, so we call it a compensatory mechanism. Okay, so when your metabolic got problem, your recipe will compensate. Okay. So you look at the respiratory component, which is your CO2. Your CO2 would be alkalosis. So that means that patient will have hyperventilation to release the excessive CO2. Okay? So one is metabolic acidosis as primary, the other one is respiratory alkalosis as secondary to try to compensate so that the system goes not that acidotic. Okay? Now, the question is, one is causing acidosis and another is causing alkalosis. Can it be an overcompensation or not? Okay. The answer is you will never get overcompensation. Okay. Compensatory mechanism cannot be total 100%. Okay. That means if I pour acid in you, no matter how good is your body buffer system, eventually your system will become slightly acidotic. You cannot overcompensate until you, when I give acid to you, you become alkaline. Understand or not? So, no question about this. The main one that go at the same direction with the pH is the main problem. Okay? The other one is just the compensatory mechanism. Okay? Let's move on to second example. So, first, when you interpret ADG, first thing we look at pH. Now, this pH is higher than normal range, so it's telling you this is an alkalosis. Okay? So next step, we look at bicarb and CO2. Bicarb is high, that is metabolic alkalosis. Same direction as the pH or not? Same. So that is the primary problem. Okay? Next, you look at CO2. CO2 is low. CO2 in this is high. That is respiratory acidosis. Different direction as your pH. So, can it be primary problem? No, that is definitely your compensatory mechanism. So, when you are in metabolic alkalosis, you got hypoventilation. Understand that? So, same principle applies. If you look at the third one, respiratory acidosis. Okay? Now, your pH is the acidotic one. Then you look at the other two components. If your bicarb is the one, alkaline, high is alkaline, right? Different direction as your acidosis. That one cannot be your main problem. Okay? Then you look at the CO2. CO2 is causing acidosis, CO2 retention, like recipe acidosis. So acidosis and acidosis, they go at same direction. So recipe acidosis is the primary problem. The other one is just a compensatory problem. Okay? So last one, recipe alkalosis. PH should be alkalotic. Okay? And you look at bicarb. Bicarb is acidotic one, different direction. So that one is a compensatory problem. CO2 is the alkalotic one, same as your pH, same direction as your pH, both also causing alkalosis. Okay, so that is the main problem, right? Primary disorder. Okay, until this, anyone got any confusion? Alright, okay, now the thing is, think about it, which one act faster? Respiratory compensation. Of course, like you're breathing that in seconds, you can get hypoventilation and hypoventilation. So meaning that when you have a metabolic disorder, your respi compensation actually kicks in very early, very fast. Okay. However, if you have a respi problem as primary, either respi acidosis or respi alkalosis, how do your metabolic response, which organ?
Kidney.
So it takes a while for your kidney to reabsorb. Your kidney mainly compensate by reabsorption of bicarb, either increased reabsorption or reduced in reabsorption of bicarb. So it takes a while for it to work. Okay? That's why sometimes from the ABG itself, we look at the degree of compensation, we know that this one is acute respiratory acidosis, or this one is chronic. Based on how much it has already worked. Okay. A lot of people are very worried about this word, compensation. Right? Compensation. Right? Is there any compensation or not? Okay. Now, first of all, when we say that sometimes our body system goes into pathology, sometimes our body are ill, right? Not everyone's kidney is functioning well, right? Sometimes they have a problem with the lung also, right? Or breathing mechanics, or brain, right? All the way from brain to spinal cord, to the nerve, to the respiratory muscle, all will control your ventilation, right? So any pathway of it, a problem, will affect your compensatory mechanism of the respiratory. Any problem with your kidney might affect your renal compensation, which is metabolic compensation. So not always when you have a primary problem, you always got compensatory mechanism. Okay? So when you interpret this ABG, if you get a primary disorder, that means pH go to white direction. That the other component, let's say is metabolic, go to the same direction, that is a primary disorder. Right? Now, when you can look at that compensatory mechanism, this is not happening. It is not happening. That means, if, for example, metabolic become acidosis, primary problem, you expect the recipe will go alkalotic, but then the recipe remains normal. Doesn't become alkalotic. CO2 doesn't go low. Okay? And your pH is still at the abnormal range. It means it is lower than 7.35. Okay, two things if your pH is abnormal. Second, if you look at the supposed to be compensatory one, but it's still normal, that means it's not healthy. It is not compensating. So we turn that. No compensation. Okay? Whoever cannot understand, please stop me. Yeah. Is that free? Okay. Now, another term is partial compensation. Okay. Partial compensation means that what? Now, use back the previous example, pH and C. The bicarb is metabolic acidosis. So, by heart, metabolic acidosis is the primary disorder. Okay? But when you look at the ECO2, respi component, yes, respi is producing some acidosis, alkalosis. That is trying to compensate. But you look at the end result pH, it's still an abnormal pH. Means that your pH is still acidotic one. Like it's not, it's being, it is not back to the range of 7.35 to 7.45. So this is called as partial compensation. Okay? Full compensation is the one that we discussed before. When you have metabolic acidosis as primary, your recipe will be alkalotic, and you look at the pH, it is normal but closer to 7.35. Right. Function what? Okay, now. So let's recap that. We are at the very, very basic step of interpreting ECG, about ABG. Only three things we look at. Okay, before we added more things inside, only three things: pH, ECO2, bicarb. Okay, first step, look at pH. That one will tell you whether it is acidosis, alkalosis, or normal. Normal, you look at whether it's nearer to the acidotic end or near to the alkalotic end. Okay, next, you look at bicarb and ECO2. Bicarb, if low, is acidotic, the other way is alkalotic. ECO2, if low, is alkalotic, if high, is acidotic. Right. So, which of the components go as the same direction as your pH? That is your primary disorder. Okay, so we term it as metabolic acidosis or respi acidosis or metabolic alkalosis or respi alkalosis. That is your diagnosis already, but not complete. You want to determine, hey, is there any compensation or not? So metabolic with respiratory compensation, which is you expect your PCO2 to be functioning. When metabolic is acidotic, for example, your PCO2 will be low because you hyperventilate, right? You have to expel out all the CO2, right? Now, if your PCO2 is low and your pH become normal range, of course it will be nearer to acidotic end. Okay, that is compensation. Already compensates by pH to be normal. Abnormal is, although it's still near to acidotic, but it's normal. Okay. If after your compensation, that means PCO2 change or not? Yes, changes, become lower. Right. But your pH remains acidotic. That is called partial. Compensate, but not enough. Okay, and compensate even more. Only so, you know, partially compensate. No compensation means that pH is acidotic. PCO2 normal range. It doesn't hyperventilate. Okay, something is wrong. Okay, so you got three types of condition: full compensation, partial compensation, and no compensation. Okay. So, yeah, this one we already go through, right? So, remember, none of the buffer cellular have the ability to overcompensate. That's a key. Now, okay, before even I go to this one, I need to tell you another condition. If, let's say, you look at pH, for example, pH is acidotic. Okay? Metabolic condition cause acidotic. L-arrestic condition also called acidosis. So that is the condition you call mixed metabolic acidosis and recipe acidosis. Okay, that means two problems, two organ system also causing acidosis. Okay. Is there any compensatory mechanism? You cannot see that. Maybe that is, but it's overwhelmed by the acidosis. Okay, so that there another extra condition called mix. You can get mixed metabolic acidosis plus recipe acidosis, and theoretically also mixed metabolic alkalosis plus recipe alkalosis. Very rare, very rare. Acidosis is more common. Okay. Okay. One of the questions they ask is that how would you know whether is there a secondary product? How do we tell if the compensatory response to mixed acid based disturbances? This is why I tell you that this topic is boring and dull because it involves mathematics. Okay? The only way to know is if you do some calculation. Okay? Can it the medical student level, usually your syllabus only cover one disorder. Means there's only one primary problem. Okay, not two, not three. Okay, so they assume that there's only one problem going wrong with the patient. That's why you come to a diagnosis of metabolic acidosis with compensation of recipe, partial, full, or no compensation. So, okay. But in reality, if you are treating patients, control patients have more than one problem. Okay, so in order to know whether you are dealing with a single problem or a hidden another problem, the only way if you use some formula to calculate. Okay, so this is actually a very well-known formula called Winkler's formula. Okay, not at your level. So I don't know you are preparing for final year, and I'm sure your memory is limited. You have more things to remember. So I don't think so. You want to memorize this. So just understand the. Okay, it's not fair. I don't think so. People will assess you on this particular. So, if you calculate, we calculate the degree of compensation. When you have, okay, Winter's formula is only used in metabolic acidosis, not recipe acidosis, not alkalosis. Only one condition, metabolic acidosis, we use it. So, in clinically, I can tell you the most common. Disorder is metabolic acidosis. You take maybe 100 ABG, 95, 96 of it will be all metabolic acidosis. Okay, so if you encounter a metabolic acidosis, the key is to calculate what is your expected BaCO2. Okay, based on your calculation, you compare with your ABG, what is the one that being measured. If your calculated one tally with the measured one, means that patient is compensating, then no issue about it. However, if the one that you measure is lower than what you expect, means there is a hidden secondary problem. Okay? The one that you measure is lower, means that patient actually has some degree of recipe alkalosis to make it even lower than expect. Okay? If the one that you measure is higher, turn out to be higher than what you expect, means that patient at the same time having concurrent respiratory acidosis. Okay, now why is it? Why is it so important? You need to know that. Okay. Why is it so important for you to know that it's actually has something to do with your clinical practice. Right? If you take ABG of the patient, for example, your common scenario like DKA, right? Metabolic acidosis, correct or not? Yeah. So we have to interpret the result, metabolic acidosis. We of course patient hyperventilate, right? Or with PCO2 is low, right? Recipe compensation. Okay. You think it's going to be full compensation or not? Initially at the beginning, yes. But can you hyperventilate for how long? Because hyperventilate forever, right? So if you don't do anything, or patient comes late to you, come to you very late, what do you think with the respiratory component? From very hyperventilation, they become very fatigued. Right? They are respiratory fatigue. So what? Once you get fatigue, what happens to your CO2? Initially, when you fully compensate, the CO2 is low. When you become fatigued, the CO2 will become high. Before become high, you become normal. That is the danger. People look at normal range, hey, normal. Without realizing that that is actually not a good sign. If you are hyperventilating, I'm more happy. If you are not hyperventilating, you are starting to have normal range, means that you are not doing that good already. You are starting to decompensate, right? And very soon you will need intubation to help with your respiration. Oh, that is your clinical importance of it. That's why people are calculating all this formula, just to see if you got metabolic acidosis and you started to have concurrent respiratory acidosis. Means that you need something more. Okay? Am I confusing you? What? Okay, so using that formula, okay. So we are just using it. Okay, so if you want the there is also formula for metabolic acidosis. But if I tell you metabolic acidosis, you don't need to remember this one, maybe you don't need to remember. Every condition, there is some formula to it, okay? To help you determine whether is there a secondary problem. Because just by interpreting the normal range, you only will know primary disorder. You assume only one problem. Very often, there is hidden problem. So this formula is helping us to know is there any secondary problem. Okay. This is for metabolic. How about respiratory? Okay. Respiratory also there is a formula for it. Everything formula. Eh? So okay. Okay. So maybe this one somebody else like I didn't mention about it. Respiratory one that is a what is it? Respiratory that is a famous formula. We call it 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 root. Okay. So if you have acute changes, for every 10 mmHg change of PCO2, you expect the bicarb will change by 1. Okay. And then, if let's say your bicarb change more than this, it's more chronic. 1 to 2. Okay, so 1 to 2, and then for chronic one is 4 to 5. Then 1, 2, 3, 4, and the 3 is actually from the bicarb. That's why the root come in 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 to help you memorize. Don't waste your memory space. Just understand the formula. We are living in the pages of technology, right? If you really, really got problems, just calculate. Maybe got some apps. Alright. So same concept apply. Same concept apply. Okay. As your metabolic disorder. If you got respiratory disorder, also you can use this formula to help you. Calculate and compare your calculate one is your expected one. and in reality, it's the one that return back in your APG. Okay? APG1 become more acidosis, that means there is a hidden metabolic disease. APG1 become more alkalotic, that is a hidden metabolic acidosis. Simple as that. Until here, any problem? Okay, so as I say, the most common problem in clinically is still your metabolic acidosis. And you know, it's not good enough to stop at the diagnosis of how the patient is having metabolic acidosis. Okay, sometimes you want to know why the patient having acidosis. Okay, so yeah, that comes in a concept of anion gap. Anion gap, is it your syllabus?
Yes.
The concept is very simple. Okay, our body, you cannot have a positive charge or negative charge, right? That means you touch a person besides you, you will get electrocuted. Right, right now. So the amount of anion and the amount of cation that present in your body is forever the same amount. Get that? So, but when you measure the patient's blood, right, inside the patient's blood for investigation, common thing that you are sending are sodium for positive charge and cation, sodium and potassium. Common and ion that you are measuring is bicarb and chloride. If you total them up, they are not always the same. Okay? The missing one is often an ion. So that's why that missing one, the gap, is called an ion gap. Right? An ion gap. So what are those an ion? Or the small little thing that you didn't usually measure in your blood, for example, ketone, your methane, all these things. Now we'll go through one by one. Now, so what is the use of measuring this anion gap? You want to know that whenever you have metabolic acidosis, not other condition like metabolic acidosis, because anion cause what? Acidosis. Okay. So whenever you have metabolic acidosis, you want to know, which of the outbreak is causing the acidosis. Or in another word, you want to find out what is the cause the patient having acidosis. Okay, so you can do by calculate the anion gap. Just like I tell you, the anion gap is the difference between positive charge and negative charge. Right? So by right, it is sodium plus potassium minus chloride and bicarb. Right, but in a lot of formula, because potassium is not high. How high can the potassium go? Any right. So a lot of formula actually they remove this potassium component. So if you very carefully look at the normal range, if your formula includes potassium, your normal range will be a bit higher. If your formula doesn't include potassium, usually the normal level for anion gap is 8 to 12. Okay. So from there you know that your when you calculate that, you will get the anion gap. So you compare whether it is same as your normal level or not. If it's within normal range, your metabolic acidosis is called a NEGMA, normal anion gap metabolic acidosis. If your anion gap is higher than the normal range, you get HEGMA, which is high anion gap metabolic acidosis. Okay, so what we know, HEGMA and NEGMA. So, delta gap, forget about it, totally not your level. Delta gap is for you to determine third problem. Okay, second problem already confusing. Third problem don't know that. After your exam, maybe like if you can Google it up, there are delta gap and also another one is delta ratio. Right? Okay. So, delta gap, delta ratio is third problem. Now forget about it, we just want to focus on secondary problem. You already have metabolic acidosis, HEGMA. Now you want to know which are the components that cause high anion gap metabolic acidosis. Now, the good thing about it is there is only this list of high anal gap metabolic disorders. We call it cat mud pump. Pneumonia is cat mud pump. So if you think about it, go through it one by one, you will be able to find the underlying culprit. Some of it, most of it are actually poisoning. So if your clinically doesn't suspicious of poisoning, you take them out. Common things clinically are probably in our part of the world is bulimia, ketone, lactate, and last is poisoning. So not many of them. So if you use this kind of mentality, just by calculate a high anion gap or normal anion gap, very quickly you can narrow down your suspect. Okay? So you don't stop at just all these patients have a metabolic acidosis. You think further what is causing the metabolic acidosis and treat the underlying cause. Okay? And normal anion gap metabolic acidosis most common cause is diarrhea. Most common cause is diarrhea. Okay. So, normal anion gap metabolic acidosis in another term of it, usually people call it hyperchloremic acidosis. You get acidosis because your chloride is more than usual. So you get hypochloremic acidosis. So most common cause is diarrhea. Second is usually your fistula, whatever fistula it is. All fistula is the fistula. Third is your RTA, renal tubular acidosis. Okay. Pneumonic is used hard. So, a little bit, what's the function of anion gap? So, quickly determine anion gap, you know it's ECMA or NECMA, and then you can narrow down, try to find the cause. So, that's what you need to investigate further. Anion gap is actually not common, but there are a few possibilities. Usually, it can do with some low protein in your blood. Don't worry though, all these slides I will say for copy here. So we have gone through a few values in your ABG. Now we haven't touched the one that we haven't touched is what this exercise. This exercise bit is what I told you lah. Very negative means very acidotic. Very positive means very alkalotic. That's all. Okay? Now, another thing that you often find in your AEG is your BaO2. Right? Actually, both AEG and BBG will have BaO2. Okay? But your question is, when are we doing AEG, when are we doing BBG? Where is your B, where is your A? Renal and urea. Which one more painful?
Urea.
Okay, so of course, there is an indication why you want to poke the patient. Arterial for people, right? So, we want to look at oxygenation level. ABG and BBG are the parameter, pH, bicarb, are they the same or not? They are almost the same. BBG will be slightly more acidotic. In terms of pH, it will be like 0.0 something lower than ABG. In terms of CO2, it will be slightly higher than ABG. Bicarb will be slightly lower than ABG. That is for academic purpose. Okay? Clinically, that difference is not enough to make any changes in your clinical management. So if your patient oxygenation level is good, then you take that SpO2 quite good, I won't bother to take ABG. That is painful. And the only situation when I want to look at ABG is when I'm interested to know what is the A. Okay, yeah. So looking at this one quite academic. Looking at ABG, the thing that we want to focus on is BaO2, small A, O2. right? What is your partial pressure of oxygen in your blood? Just now we tell you that the normal range is 80 to 100. Okay. And that is a formula. I don't know whether you remember or not last time, Hochheim, physiology. All this is called the AGE, alveolar gas equation. This is the formula. Okay. So, clinically, nobody likes to bring calculator and enter the figure 1.1. So, that is actually a shortcut. But to know the shortcut, you have to understand this. Right. So, I give you a scenario. If the patient is, you want to take that normal range, 80 to 100, or you want 60 to 100, that normal range, you have to put the patient on room air. Then you take the ABG. Right, but how many patients can tolerate on room air? Not many. So if your patient is not misophone, base mask, hypomask, all oxygen, you take ABG, come back, what do you think is a PaO2? High. 300 is high a lot. 500 is high a lot. But are you happy with that or not? So to help you, this is the formula that you need to give you. Calculate what is the normal AA gradient. And okay, so AA gradient also affected by patient H. Affected by patient H. Okay, so the formula is H plus 4 divided by 4. That is your expected normal range for AA gradient. Okay, so you give in the AA gradient. FiO2 is the partial bond pressure of oxygen that you're giving the patient. You're giving 100%, that is 1.0. You're giving 80%, that is 0.8. Atmospheric pressure is same as 760, right? Usually we take at 760. But not to forget, in our air, not only gas, but it includes water as vapor. So usually that figure is about 46. And PaCO2 is what you obtain from your patient, the gas. And lastly, PaO2. Okay. This PaO2 is This PaO2 is actually the one that you calculate and expect. Okay, your expected PaO2. When you take patient ABG, the ABG result come back and you compare and you will know that whether the patient having higher or lower than your expectation or not. Yeah. Now, this big thing, the bracket is P big AO2. Big AO2 means that partial pressure of oxygen at the level of your alveolus. Big A is alveolus. The one that you measure, P small AO2, is from your artery. By right, whatever that happens in your alveolus and your artery, are they the same or not? Mm-hmm. Should be the same, right? But what causing them to be different? We call it BQ mismatch. Okay? Happen because of two reasons. One is maybe you got oxygen there, but no blood there. Right? Blood are wasted going to other places that don't go there. Or secondly, is shunt. You got some right to left shunt, right? So your blood actually bypassed, didn't go through your lung. So it's shunted away. So your oxygen, when you check your PaO2, will become lower than what you expect. So it's just all mathematics. All mathematics. Okay? Clinically, usually we take a shortcut. Okay, I don't like to calculate all these things. So, right, so shortcut is we know the patient oxygen concentration. Say he's on face mask oxygen. I know that face mask oxygen give you 40 to 60% of oxygen. So I times 5. The factor is about 5. We know that is a minimum that patient should have. So 5 times 40 will give you 200. So 200, if I take the ABG and look at PaO2, if PaO2 is something less than 200, I get very worried. Okay, because the patient is in fact having hypoxia. Okay, don't be happy because 200 or is more than 200. Right. Okay. So for example, if the patient is on 100% oxygen, and take the initial aspect, the patient to at least must have PaO2 of at least 500 plus 25. Okay? So when I look at my ABG, if it's anything less than 500, I won't be happy. Even if it's a 450. Get that concept or not? Why? What is the basis of me doing that? Based on this one. The times 5 is of course a round estimation. Won't be as accurate as using AGP formula estimation. But clinically, we use the times 5 rule. Okay. So, first example, a patient who was admitted to CCU because of AFI, you take the APG, and you get this kind of result. Can someone interpret pH is? Is my cup is?
No.
Okay, so it's acidosis or acidosis? And PCO2 is? Normal. So your diagnosis for this would be? Metabolic acidosis, no respiration. Yeah. It's the same. Now, what caused this metabolic acidosis? Yeah, very good. But only lactic acidosis. You think about it, right? When you are having MI, yes, your heart is failing, right? Cardiogenic shock, not enough of blood going to your whole body. So your whole body go into anaerobic metabolism. Okay, they are not using oxygen enough to metabolize, so they produce lactate. So you get lactic acidosis one. When you don't have enough perfusion to the whole body, including your kidney might go into AKI, acute renal injury, right? So, what component in your AKI will raise? What component in your RP will raise?
Urea.
And urea cause acidosis or not?
Yes.
You remember your mark. All right. Urea is acidosis. So you have to determine if it's really active load or check and see the AKI already, yeah, so it's what acidotic. And another thing, when you're having stress, stress hormone, so your body will produce stress hormone. Okay, so what do you think about the sugar level? All this, when you're having illness, your body thinks that, oh, you need a lot of substrates, and they break down other things that you can break down. All your stress hormones are activating. So your sugar will go high, and very often you'll get what's called hyperglycemic condition. So if your lactate can be measured online, you can check your lactate is normal. You can check your urea is normal or not high enough to explain that. Next, you want to check what?
Ketone.
Or you check your glucose first. Right. That is how you think. Okay? Don't be happy at all. This one must be that. Know how to treat? You treat accordingly, right? If let's say it's purely lactic acidosis, you want to increase perfusion, to the body, right? You want to, if it's underlying MI, of course, you deal with the blockage first, open up the blockage, and then bring up the PI. Right? Of course, you don't want to stress the heart too much, then maybe you put vasopressor instead of inotrope that cause heart and my heart to beat even harder. Right, but you bring up the BP, increase the perfusion to the body, then hopefully your lactate will reduce. So if it's that you settle the uremia also, because you increase back the perfusion to the kidney. Okay? If it's a DKA, you treat as DKA only, but you will be very, very careful to want to give a lot. Yeah, because the other component about stress apart. Okay. Okay. 44 years old gentleman presents with severe diarrhea with moderate dehydration. let's look at the APG. Interpretation, creation, acidosis, backup, metabolic, acidosis, resting component. So that is recipe. Acidosis. So only one problem. What is your acidosis? Single problem. Acidosis with partial. Why partial? Because pH is never normal. Okay. So what do you think about PO2? Quite good luck. Better having HE only, right? What to make you think is the main cause that caused this metabolic acidosis? Yes. Look at the urea. What's your normal range for urea? Single digit one, right? This one? So it explains. So this patient diarrhea until dehydration and so maybe pre-existing hemosalpinin problem too. Right, so moderate of dehydration, not enough perfusion to give me, energy gone. Right, so it becomes AKI. So how are you going to treat? Rehydrate back the patient, right? And not only rehydrate back, but you look at the component. If the electrolytes, potassium is low, you want to give some potassium inside. Okay, how about chloride? Chloride is a quite a normal one, right? Yeah, no. So you determine which one is the best fluid to give. If you give too much of your sodium chloride, might not be good because you're actually causing hyperchloremic acidosis. Okay? If you probably the better choice in this case is to give almond. Okay? Almond also contains potassium and almond contains less. So you know which one to give. Yeah. It's like 1 dm presents with ED, is your vomiting or yeah. It's not very textbook, noted that kidney dehydrated. So your APG interpretation is what happened to the PCO2? Compensate or not? This is dangerous, you know. That means your hypoventilation already start to it's not that low already. If you give the if you tell me the backup is 10, I would expect the PCO2 to be much lower, right? And that patient already hypoventilated and at the stage of week 2 fatigue out already. Okay. So no question about the diagnosis. I don't know it's TKA, right? The sugar is high, the check the ketone is positive, and it's explosive. No, it's okay. You want to your treatment for this patient is first is fluid resuscitation. Always fluid resuscitation first, okay? Not insulin, you know. When the patient is dehydrated, your insulin action is actually erratic. That's not enough to perfusion to the function organ. So firstly, the fluid going first, aggressively, is only 22 years old, usually you can take it. If you're like 70, 80 years old, I'm really a bit afraid that to give that much fluid at this short time. Young patient, one to three. Okay. After you start to rehydrate a bit, then only you talk about insulin and also before that first, underlying cause, okay? Is there any triggering factor or any aggravating factor? So treatment of DKA quite standard, starts and insulin, underlying cause, like, sepsis, infection, right? And dextrose is when your sugar go too low. Right? When your sugar go too low, you have a lot of sugar. But the problem is sugar doesn't go to the blood organ. Like they all run at your sugar is happily swimming in your blood. Right? So you want the sugar to go into your cells. That's why you want to give insulin down. After you give insulin, sugar starts to go down. You don't want that sugar to change too much. Why? Two reasons. One is because you want to supply more sugar so that more food to the cell. We replenish the store. Right? But you don't want the sugar to drop too fast because you don't want the osmolarity to change too fast. Okay, that will affect your brain. What happens if your sugar, your osmolarity from outside the brain cells from too high to too low? Water will go, the osmolarity right will go to your cell and cause cerebral. Okay. What is this? pH is alkalotic. PCO2 is alkalotic. Bicarb is alkalotic. So what is the problem? Respi more or metabolic more? So I can tell you this creature actually must have more than one problem. Maybe it's a three problem. So what does your Nyssa diuretics do? It actually is a diuretic, right? So first of all, it draw what? Water out of your body. Second, it's a loop diuretic, right? So it inhibits the sodium, potassium, chloride pump. So when you that pump is inhibited, cannot reabsorb sodium and potassium, and you cannot speed up your chloride. So what do you expect happen to the patient? Chloride is high, yes. Then potassium is low in your body. Okay, this is a situation that in your question they ask about chloride resistant alkalosis. This type of patient, if you assess that they are clinically dehydrated. That's a lot of water coming out, right? But if you treat them with just normal saline, they are resistant. It won't improve. Why? Because the body already got a lot of chloride. The fact that this diuretic is blocking the chloride. Right? You chloride, no use one. Right? So how are you? Okay, so their problem is what we call as contraction. Contraction of alkalosis. Yeah, volume is contracting. Extracellular volume is contracting. Contraction of alkalosis. Or another description is actually chloride resistant alkalosis. So what are you going to do?
Change.
Yes. Stop the diuretic. And replace your another diuretic, no. Already volume is already low, right? Your volume is not anything.
Rehydrate
the picture. Probably you don't want to choose the fluid that contains high level of chloride does not. Like apartment got lower chloride, or you want to choose some other newer brand of fluid if you have right. Now, this one is actually not like a dying emergency. Okay? You don't have to like aggressively do something, you know, it's time for it to go. the more dangerous side is still acidosis rather than acidosis. ABG, ABH is acidosis, acidosis is CO2. Recipe acidosis, my cup. Partial compensation. Partial compensation. Another issue is PO2. If let's say it's an ABG, and this one must be ABG, like your ABG cannot achieve PO2. So, it's hypoxia, right? If the CO2 raise, that is like 2 respirators. So, what is happening? What is going on in this patient? Why is CO2 retention? How much edema cause CO2 retention? Hypoxia maybe lah. Hey, CO2 retention. When you got hypoxia, maybe a patient has hypoxia. At one point, he got hypoventilating. Or another possibility, 70 years old with chronic heart failure, also properly they are smoker. So sometimes they got mixed COPD also. So we have to determine which one is which one. And if it's a COPD, yeah, you can still keep proper ventilator. If it's not, it is hypoventilation that causing the place in this CO2. You need to give some support already, not only oxygen, but even oxygen. It's a ventilation issue, it's not oxygen. Okay? Patient lung is not ventilating. Okay. This one? Chronic smoker, cough, SOB, BP, very common. EH is? Acidosis. PCO2 is? Raspy, acidosis. PO2? Okay lah, when we are back up. So this one is recipe. So this if you realize that you actually see a lot of patients walking around with PCO2, 60 some patients walking around with PCO2, 70, 80. Right. Some of them are, this is their usual value. So you have to know whether you want to treat this patient or not. Okay. So whether you can discharge from hospital or you must aggressively treat this patient based on whether is that an acute exacerbation or not. Okay. So if it's an acute exacerbation, the renal compensation won't be that much. Okay. If your renal compensation already, your vital already high, means that this thing has been going on for some time. Because I tell you, kidney compensate slowly, right? So that's why the 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 group tells you that how to differentiate whether it's acute or chronic. Okay? So you need to do a little bit of calculation. Okay? If clinical experience, I know what you do like this one. So at least a chronic already. Okay? So if you not that familiar with interpretation, then the paksa is going to look up and study the formula. Then you find out, okay, all this is actually called. Okay? Another way is if you don't know calculation, what you do? You go and trace back the patient's old ABG, and maybe it's both speed and it's before. This patient previous ABG PCO2 is already like that. Upon discharge, I'm not the one mentioned. concepts. Okay? Then you know that this is normal. That PCO2 base is something chronic. Okay? It's not acutely increased. And there's two ways for you to how to deal with this. Clinically, patient usually is comfortable because it's already accommodated. If after your calculation, this is an acute concept of CO2 retention or acute respiratory acidosis, then you can first treat the patient at capacity. Try to bronchodilate and repeat. If not, not getting better, you want to sleep off after once you treat the patient already. This one? pH is? CO2 is? Backup is? Patient's pink and black. So be careful, my other patient is ill-appearing, something is wrong. Pumping is wrong. So we don't want to treat the number, we treat the patient. Okay? So doesn't mean that everything is normal, the patient is normal. This is a mixed condition. Okay. When you are vomiting, what happens? Your gastric juice come out, right? Gastric juice is what? HCl, acid. Right. So your upper vomiting, recurrent severe vomiting, you'll get metabolic alcohol. When you are drinking a lot of alcohol, what happens to your blood? You got alcoholic ketoacidosis. Correct or not? Huh? If you are, usually when you are drinking a lot of alcohol, it's also a diuretic, and then you're vomiting also, causing you to lose weight. Right? So your body will be dehydrated. This patient is also getting dehydrated. Right. So when you have dehydration, lack of perfusion, your lactate will go high, your urine will go high. So you got certain things that causing acidosis, which is lactate, ketone, urea. There are certain things that cause alkalosis, which is loss of HCl. So that is the reason why your ABG appears as much normal. So do not trust that the people alone look at your patient. Your patient, by look, you know that this patient is not that okay. Okay, so you still have to treat whatever. Even if patient is dehydrated, you finish your treat. Right. If it's really going to some or what, you treat the kidney. Right. You see the whether the kidney is bad enough or not. In fact, maybe you need to do a dialysis, you know. Oh, I told you. This kind of intervention, everything normal, discharge your patient, shouldn't be your workflow. Okay? Check your patient first, right? Of course, if you will use the delta ratio or what, then you can get this. Okay. Understand? Okay, what is your pH? PO2? Patient on what? 3 liters of nasal flow oxygen is 32%. Don't take it at 30%. You expect the PO2 to be? So your PO2 of 85 is not to PO2, let's say PCO2. Okay, so this is what type of respiratory failure type 1. If I got whether they didn't give, okay, now I just focus on the O2. Happy with that O2? SPO2, you have to take the probe 96% in the one. That is, what is your likely diagnosis? Tachycardia, 25 years old, sudden onset SOP after a Fat metabolism. What type of metabolism? Fat metabolism. Fat metabolism. The fracture happened when?
6 days.
6 days ago. The fat takes 6 days to embolize. So? DVD, more likely, right? If let's say day one and maybe like fat metabolism, and fat metabolism doesn't happen at extramedullary fracture, it happens at low bone, the shaft. Okay, not extramedullary. Okay, so and 6 days lying on the bed, that is DVD, that is not fat. Okay, A gradient no need to know. Correct. Any questions so far? Anyone getting more Okay, thank you.
You are 60%. No.